Hey, what's up, everyone? Andrew Kramer here, and we're doing a sweet interview. So I was doing a keynote at Blend in 2017, and I was headed over to the venue, and everybody was just outside getting ready for registration, and a group of people came up to me and they said, hey, we're really big fans, and you have a lot of fans in Taiwan, and you know, can maybe we get a picture? And I said, yeah, sure. And so, you know, we filmed a little video and took a little picture, and you know, they were just super nice. And when they asked me to come out to this event, when they reminded me of who they were, let's just say it really helped convince me to come out, because it was just a really nice encounter. So some of my kids know a little bit about what I do, and you know, they'll say things like, oh, my dad works on movies, which is part of what I do, I think, and I think that's like an easier thing to relate to. Actually, quick story, I went to my daughter's like middle school class to do like a presentation about like, hey, like graphics or whatever, and it's like, yeah,
Father's Day, or
like kind of like a career day.
Oh, okay.
And you know, I said, yeah, so I did this work on Star Wars, and the kids are like, did you work on any video games? And I was like, well, they're like, Minecraft. I'm like, look, I gotta go. But it was a lot of fun, and I think, you know, the real fun thing about visual effects is it's just becoming more common. Like, people understand, just like, you know, we might have understood photoshopping 10 years ago. I think visual effects is a very common thing, and I think that makes it a little bit more relatable. But to get back to your question, I think they definitely get a sense of what it is, and if anything, I just try to like teach my kids to understand that the hard work that you put into stuff, you know, whether it's like writing or drawing or something, that that's not time that's wasted, and that, you know, people will appreciate hard work. So I try to, you know, not bore them with all of the details of what I do, but try to, you know, encourage them in the things that they're doing. So I would say that, you know, the longer I've done it, the more I realize the importance of focusing on creating high quality content. And I think now more than ever, there's so much content being created, and the way I think to stand out is that you make things that are valuable to learn, and that tools that are valuable to use. And that sort of has helped guide me as far as where I focus my efforts. Now, as an artist myself, I want to be able to have a lot of real production experience. So like when I'm working on, you know, a title sequence, I want to feel like I'm pushing the limits and improving my skills. And simultaneously, that challenge actually helps to develop the tools that we create. So for example, we're working on a volumetric 3D rendering tool, and that's right, Nebula, and a lot of that was influenced by the THX title sequence that we worked on. So this new plugin is called Nebula 3D, and it's a 3D volumetric rendering plugin inside of After Effects. So volumetric light and also volumetric VDB shading. And the idea is that when you're doing your compositing, that's where you do a lot of, you know, making things look good. Lens flares, color correction. And so if you want volumetrics, typically that's going to take a lot of time to render, and also you're sort of stuck with the result. And so by having it be a post-process that you mix with a Z depth pass, you can actually refine it and actually use it to develop the look of your 3D renders. And so by leveraging GPU technology, we're able to get it to work really, really fast, and allow you to have a bunch of different lights inside of your scene and do it at the comp level at the end. Yeah, so how much do we want to get into this? Yeah. Oh, okay, I've got it. So one of the things that we're realizing more and more is that as people get better at using After Effects, or better at using Cinema 4D, that they need something more than just single tutorials that focus on a single idea, but something that can sort of fill in the gaps of their, you know, education and the things that they need to know on the job, you know, in a production environment. And so what we've, You know, we've done this in the past with tutorial series that are a little bit longer, but I think even those are really refined to focus on exactly what you need to know. And sometimes in production, it's not as clear cut. So our idea with this new training series is that we create training that are based on projects, but they keep all of the challenges in it, and they don't necessarily, you know, are designed to be 25 minutes long, but instead they're as long as they need to be. So some are 5 tutorials, some are, you know, 2 hours or 5 hours. And what this allows us to do is reach out to other sort of creative experts and allow them to sort of break their process down. And, you know, like, I don't know how to use every software. And I feel like if I'm only showing people what I know, then that's limiting them on what they could possibly learn. And so I think the more talented people that we can bring together, we can create a more complete, you know, training series and training course for people to learn from. Yeah, I think, you know, as visual effects has sort of evolved, you know, the excitement of it isn't as impactful to audiences because we've seen so many great things happen on screen. But the things that stick with us the most are the moments or characters, you know, the interesting, unique characters and the situations. And so if you think about that sort of paramount as the first thing that comes to mind when you think about a movie or a scene that you really like, you don't really think about the visual effects. But if we can come up with stories and ideas that resonate, that will, I think, even inspire more, you know, compelling visual effects. I think a lot of the really interesting visual effects comes from interesting scenarios or perspectives that maybe you wouldn't expect, and that just gets married together into sort of a memorable, you know, scene or movie. One sort of interesting one was the film Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, because, you know, they're doing a sort of like a period film, and like you see them get on the freeway, and maybe it's not all visual effects, but it sort of highlights the challenge of even doing a movie 20 years ago, because you don't have modern cars driving on the freeway. You know, so the shot, they're on the freeway and you see all the cars down and all the cars passing, and they're all like 1980s, 1990s cars. And just little details like that. I saw a discussion online recently about how the invisible visual effects don't get noticed, and even to the point where, you know, film directors are promoting the sort of practical, you know, the sort of buzzword of, oh, it's all shot practically, when in reality it's visual effects that are created to be seamless and invisible. And, you know, that kind of work, I think, needs to get appreciated more, because it's the stuff that sort of holds together these films. You know, it's so challenging. You know, I don't pretend to know the sort of business side of running a visual effects studio, but, you know, I know how hard visual effects artists work. And unfortunately, you know, the business is, you know, very cutthroat, and, you know, the challenges of, you know, where work is created. And at the end of the day, the studios just want high quality work. And I don't think they really want to know what it takes to get that work done. And so, you know, in a way they can sort of just look the other way while the studios are sort of struggling to sort of find a balance that works. What I would say is teams, smaller teams, you know, 3 to 5, you know, designers and creators, I think is a really powerful concept right now, because the software and technology is making it so much more capable, you know, for simulations and, you know, really high in 3D, that you can do it with a small team of people. And I feel like the risk is a bit lower than scaling up to the size of, you know, 100 employees. So as far as like, if you're really good at 3D and maybe you can put together a sort of crack team of a few people, I feel like the risk is lower for you, and you know, you can still participate in doing, you know, really ambitious projects. It's like, the bigger the machine, the bigger the risk. And you know, I've been lucky in my career to not have to navigate that as sort of meticulously. So, you know, maybe I'm not the best person to ask as far as like what you should do about it. But I know that the people that I've seen that are really happy and able to sort of drive their career the way that they want to are the people who work with small teams and they sort of float into different projects that don't maybe, they probably don't go over six people. The first time was actually in Japan, where I went out with our partners Flashback, and we didn't really know exactly what we were doing, but we were basically showing cool things that, you know, we were working on, techniques, and just showing it to an excited group of CG artists. Now, the Europe tour started as an idea to, well, I'd never been to Europe, so I thought, well, maybe I'll go, and you know, I had a friend that runs a CG meetup, and we got to talking, and we're like, man, you're gonna, you know, pack all your bags to go all the way to Europe. Like, maybe we could turn this into something more. And so the idea started saying, well, where are some of the places that I'd like to visit? So, we looked at, you know, just we looked at like where could we go to, you know, meet as many people as possible and show people, you know, tips, tricks, things, and have other artists come together and show the work that they're creating, and just try to create a fun place for CG artists to get together. And so that was the genesis of the more ambitious tour. And it was really successful. It was a lot of fun. You know, we filmed a bunch of behind the scenes and just sort of captured the, you know, the excitement of it all. And you know, I'm still sort of like looking back and thinking, wow, it was a fun ride.
So this is the event we can expect this year?
So I don't know that I want to just do it every year, but I would definitely say that it's something that I think we can do frequently, you know, and maybe it's every 18 months or maybe it's every 2 years, but we just want to make sure that we're bringing high quality speakers and having really meaningful things to say. Like, it's not our core business to do these tours. It's something that we think if we can contribute to our community, then we want to do it, and not just to, you know, have fun and go on a European vacation. I promise that wasn't what. Mehdi worked on the title sequence, I think, for the Paris show, and he is this phenomenal CG artist, and he used Cinema 4D and Octane to render this like beautiful sequence. And so what we did is we wanted to create unique title sequences for each of the shows, and so we actually worked with different artists for each of the shows, and everyone put on their own sort of spin on, you know, that particular show and their skills and as an artist. And you know, I was just so proud to see such an amazing range of work. We have just recently released the Japan Video Copilot Live titles, which were just like super fun. You know, I think that would be a fun thing to keep doing in the future. In that case, it was more just like, you know, sometimes having to, you know, say, hey, how about this? You limit the possibilities. And so honestly, we just said, hey, you're so talented, go and make something amazing. And that reminds me actually of something, like I was lucky to have a similar situation when I worked with JJ Abrams at Bad Robot, where I wasn't always given like, okay, do exactly this, but more so the flexibility to sort of try things out and to experiment. And I think some of the best, most interesting things came from not having to be so refined in the beginning, and then as you go, you know, you sort of polish it. So yeah, next week we're going to Japan, and we have one show in Tokyo, and I'll be talking a lot about this recent title sequence I worked on for THX, which involved a massive CG sequence from, you know, a galaxy to a dragonfly to a spaceship, this whole, and basically breaking down some of the challenges, some of the things that worked good, some of the things that didn't quite work out, and hopefully share some tips and tricks, and of course maybe a few surprises, maybe take a look at Nebula and some of the sort of secret things that we haven't been sharing entirely. So yeah, I think we're I have a lot of goals, but I think next year is going to be about releasing the tools that we've been working on for the past 2.5 years, and one of them being Element 3D version 3, which we think is a really major upgrade from the last version. And I think the kinds of things that you'll be able to do inside of After Effects with this version is I'm really excited about it, and I can't wait to show, you know, the things behind it. Yeah, all right, thanks, appreciate it.
Thank you.